I mean, homeless is probably a very small proportion, but in terms of the volume of patients that could be cared for in homes with some support, that's quite high. And certainly, I think you probably come later with some of your finance papers, but I think the local authority has heavily invested over a number of years in expanding that type of service. The number of companies that engage with or direct employees to try and provide those packages of care at home, really. But at the moment, the demand still outstrips supply in terms of timeliness. You know, it's how fast you can access that. And there are no impede pressures for this particular workforce that, you know, like a minimum wage, and therefore, certainly around both Christmas and summer times, you see a drop in that workforce, and therefore it can back up across the rest of the cities.
So I judge if members have had their questions answered. Because Mr. Middleton has mentioned the role of authority, maybe appropriate for him to comment a little bit about the commissioning. So I've been trying to note some of the points members have put, and probably cover those in some summary when I've heard from Graham.
Thank you, Matthew. Some very interesting comments about the whole system that came out today. And I know that most of that has been looked at in a lot of detail in terms of how the emergency care system works together. I think for me, what it does illustrate is it's really important to have a proper overview of the system as opposed to a fragmented view of the system, which you know, I think there is a difference between the focus being on getting people out of hospital and the focus being on outcomes for the residents of Wirral, which I think is what we're trying to do as commissioners. And that does mean that we have a whole range of different services that contribute in slightly different sorts of ways. But I have to take some points away. I am concerned to hear that there have been some pressures in terms of the social work workforce, because as far as I'm aware, they've not been formally escalated in any way, shape or form towards us as the commissioner. So I think that if we're not following those formal processes, then I need to understand why they come out in meetings like this as opposed to through a formal process. But in terms of the four seasons, I think that's the key point today, is that we do know in terms of our duties as a council to commission the whole care sector, that four seasons is a provider that has two inadequate homes on the roof. The detail of that is being looked at in some detail as part of the performance committee of this committee. So that's really important in terms of understanding what's going on with Four Seasons as a provider, because any element of what happens in Four Seasons has an impact in a more broad sense. At this stage, commissioners locally are meeting weekly with Four Seasons. The concerns that high. And the regional managers are coming from Four Seasons to meet with them in terms of what they're actually doing to turn around the situation. So I think in terms of Reverton Nursing Home and in terms of Park House, you know, the concerns are very significant to us. So I accept what Anthony said, that this is separate to what's happening in relation to this ward. But clearly, if an organisation takes a decision to move a profit-making part of the organisation away, which parts of the organisation, then actually the impact on those other parts is even higher. So that's just something that we need to be aware of, but also, you know, it does supplement the issue around actually we need to have a full view as opposed to a view of one part of the market. Thank you, Chair.
I try to note down the key issues that concern members. If I miss them, I'm sure members will tell me. First of all, we thank Mr. Middleton for giving us some detailed understanding of the operational model. But the committee wants further assurances about the quality of the inspections given the prevalence of amber-related scores in the documentation we received. And we also believe that the internal inspections should be made available to officers for examination so they can judge just how independent they are. And I think that we remain concerned about future ownership of the operator assess what we've said and to speak with the operator and your staff to see just quite what can be provided to us that will give us a further assurance. A number of members have indicated, so I'll just see Councillor Muspratt first, please.
Yes, thank you, Chair. I am concerned about that destination of discharge because I don't think I'm the only person who thought that when we were first had it explained to us that this was for people who would not require much care. It was just a case of getting things ready for the war or just getting them in the right mood to go out. So these. The grey and mustard are quite large, and after the explanation I began to wonder whether, because they have to fill 30 beds, are they actually taking people who wouldn't normally be taken if there were people who were going back to their own homes? And in that instance, who makes the decision that it's those people who go into this ward and not go elsewhere? Is it just like the normal bed giving up at that point? Because there are two systems running on where there's the 30 beds paid for all the time, and there's the, but they've got to have the 30 beds, and there's the other one where they get the money whether the beds are empty or not. I think part of the problem is because there's no true system yet, it's all being presumably from what Christina said, it's all being looked at the moment. And they're looking for the best option. But I would like to understand that destination of discharge. If it is that people deteriorate, that's one thing. But if it is that it was known when they went there that they were going to possibly, as likely as not, be in the residential care or back into the system, I think we need to know that.
That's the point of officers reported Mr. Middleton takes it away. Very black in my mind, I've got this phrase medically optimised, which might be quite wrong, but I have proof that the purpose of the service was to help people not make money for four seasons. I think it's what one is meant. Another member indicated that I was sorry, Councillor Rowlands, thank you.
Yeah, but they did look behind something I was alluding to in the questions about profitable size of the business being sold off and what impact that was going to have on the less profitable size of the business. I think that is quite a concern that I would like to see some sort of report on if and when that comes about. I think we need to understand what impact that would have on the other parts of the business because it would certainly affect.
So, as I understand it, a group of officers noted down the points of my earlier. I'm afraid my writing is so bad that I've had to repeat it word for word. But if members took the gist of what I said, take on board what Councillor Muspratt wished to raise, as we can't remember me, Councillor Muspratt sought more information on, and take account of the concerns raised by Councillor Rowlands about the business nature, perhaps cross subsidy from this to other parts of the business. It's an understanding of that we're still seeking. I'll take Councillor Norbury, but I didn't believe we'd covered most of the issues, but I'll hear what you have to say.
Just some concern regarding what Graham said, that if my understanding was you weren't aware that there was social work issues, but you know the two departments aren't talking to each other.
So just to come back, what I actually said was it wasn't formally escalated within the process. So there is always a very close working relationship in terms of the social workers who work within the team that the trust manages, which is the integrated discharge team, which Anthony and Co are responsible for. There is also the community foundation trust in terms of assessments in the community, etc. What I'm saying is that as the commissioner of those services, there hasn't been a formal escalation, although this is the second time I've heard the trust talk about it. Issues in terms of social work. So, what I'm concerned about is the lack of formal escalation in such a significant issue.
Thank you. Would that be part of our recommendations?
Well, I think that we ask that the Director for Adult Care and Health reports back to us on formal arrangements so we are satisfied that they exist. Now, we covered that item. Thank you, Mr. Middleton, for taking questions.
sorry, forget myself.
If you want to come forward and give us some advice on how our finances or overall finances are faring. Times at this point that I don't have a screen to look at, so I'm going to start giving myself some neck exercises. So if I move slightly outside, you'll appreciate that I don't do that for you. So bear with me while I move and then we'll all be able to see what's on the screen. Is that right?
It's not seven.
Right. So financial monitoring report. Have you got the thing that you want to display or just going to talk to Mr. Gottswein?
If my intention, Chairman, is just to talk through the report.
Right. So I don't have to move. Thanks very much. Because we're used to having some figures thrown up on the screen, if there are materials that you refer to that you'd like to circulate to us, that would be very helpful.
Yeah. Absolutely no material, all things that I'll be referring to at the end of the report, but I'll certainly make reference to those. First of all, thank you very much for having me. Would you prefer, Chair, me to go through this report, or if people have already digested it, would you prefer to go straight to questions?
My belief, knowing members are diligent, is that members will have read it, and therefore I think it's in the interest of everyone's time to key questions. So I'm going to ask members who've got the queries to indicate and then we can go through them. Who would like to be first over the stocks with a query on the finances? Right. Councillor Cottier, do you have a
just on 3.1.7, it refers to the CCG's deficit and the £200,000 that was required to go towards mitigating that, £100,000 of which came from one of our councils. Can you tell me what that money went towards? What was the deficit? And that was a month that the council money spent on.
Thank you. So as you correctly said, the pooled fund balance in 2018-19 was a deficit of £200,000. And the legal, the contractual relationship to the council and CCG in relation to the pool fund requires us to share. So the cause of the pressure, as you rightly pointed out, is because of increases in expenditure in continuing healthcare, called CHC, particular packages of care, which are fully funded by the health service. And elements of those packages are included, or a number of those packages, I should say, contained within the pool fund. And as I say, the deficit position on those lines within the pool fund. That's sure the responsibility for that, if you like, is borne equally between the council and the CCG. So it's £100,000 of the council's allocation that was put into the pool and into the balance sheet.
Generally, across the whole, the deficit is not in a particular element towards. Sorry,
if you're going to put your microphone on, we'd all be able to hear, and I suspect that the webcasting mechanism would also pick you up better if you have the microphone on.
Sorry, Chair.
We all forget, don't worry about it.
So there's nothing specific you can tell us on that was went on?
So within the pool fund, our budget lines for those packages of continuing healthcare, which have overspent, so that money goes directly towards balancing that. Does that answer the question, or am I managing
it? Continuing healthcare is quite a generic sort of term, isn't it?
Yeah, sorry, can I refer you to Graham from Gosses?
Here's Graham, has an answer.
Okay, now to start this thought, there is a very straightforward answer, which is you pool the NHS continuing care, i.e. the money that NHS pays for complex packs of care for people with disabilities, alongside the local authority money for people with care packages, so that you don't have to argue about who pays for those packages, hence the overspend is about 50-50. So it is one pool of money, and that's why we've shared that number. The answer to your question, absolutely, is it's gone on individual people's care and support at home.
Councillor Nolan.
Thank you, Chair.
use of technology solutions that are available now that potentially weren't available 2 or 3 years ago that permit people to stay at home and for longer and forestall that requirement for them to go into long-term residential nursing care. So while there are significant increases in those areas, the financial impact of those increases in those areas is significantly less than would have been the case had those increases been seen in the residential nursing care sector. Does that answer the first question?
Not entirely. Because my question was about
Wallasey,
which is
altogether, the Department has said its targets agreed with its NHS providers of 500 houses together, which is designed to meet the initial forecast budget assets at the start of the year. And you're absolutely right, using assistive technology and using supportive living is a key part of that, but it's not the entirety of that. So, in addition to those two items, the Department has also invested significantly in terms of the council scheme and use of extra care housing. Different level of support, again, slightly less intensive support in residential and nursing. The authority is also, the department is also in a constant state of ensuring that the packages of care that are for individuals are correct or appropriate. There's a constant series of reviews being done with our systems teams to ensure that our payment processes are correct, that any double payments, for instance, are recovered to make sure that we're financially resilient to make us in that respect. And we'd say the general process is led by our NHS providers, because that would be the social workers, some of those areas where they believe that those efficiencies can be estimated. The other area, the significant area where savings. So settings where efficiencies are being achieved, it's ensuring that where packages of care have significant or the majority aspect of healthcare or NHS provided care, that the council is recovering all the funds that are nice and proper for it to receive back from the NHS in respect of continuing healthcare, so joint funding packages of care as well.
Perhaps if I come in as chair briefly, I think that the book plans on the desk of the people who are actually commissioning services, individual members of staff who are looking at what a citizen and resident needs and trying to guarantee them what they need. No offence, but your key role is monitoring how we're performing against the savings targets that the council set ourselves and probably ring alarm bells if the processing of the material suggested that wasn't the case. It seems to me that that this is Nolan was asking about, was rationing, because in the past, I'll get this scale right, because I'm sure there's a scale of levels of service which authorities were really trying to help people reaching a point of scale 8 and 9, and were effectively not providing services to lower down those scales. That's a layman's explanation, but as I understand it, the council set a budget which had these particular targets to be achieved which officers believed could be achieved, and our assurance is that looking for that they can be achieved without detriment to individuals who genuinely need services. I think that's the angle I'm coming from, and Graham might be able to help us.
So this is the budget that we set, as you know, that was set last year, and the land disability savings there are the third year, subsequent year, overall on adult social care, it's comparatively higher in the area of learning disabilities than it is on OLP. So our old people's spend is relatively small. In terms of managing the older people's budget, then the focus has been on supporting people much more in their own homes than in residential and nursing care, so that overall the cost of supporting people goes down. People with learning disabilities can very much about the volume of support people get, and also making sure that we work together with the NHS to make sure that what we put is the most effective package for people, as opposed to a package which has elements of health and elements of social care that could be bolted together. So that's, I guess, an overarching element. In terms of the criteria that Chair's mentioned then, there used to be an eligibility criteria based around the level of support that people require. However, that was changed significantly with the coming of the Care Act, where now the legislation has changed significantly. The criteria is broader than it ever was before. So that as well as people who require support and activities of daily living, also issues around people's well-being to matter as well. So there's a much broader remit in social care. What that leads to is a position whereby what we do is try to pull on a number of resources, which includes what the person can do for themselves, how their families can support them, as well as what we can do in terms of service provision. That does lead to a broad picture in terms of
the council with the £904,500 that I proposed.
some detailed comments about the progress that's being made and certain comments on the role of social workers and how people are working together in the environment. It might be best if all members receive that, and we'd all be better informed. I think that would be very helpful. It wasn't a lengthy report, but it has some key points. Councillor Nolan.
Chair, could I just suggest that I pass to a future meeting?
When we get it, because the report was compiled in a peer review in April, maybe it'll be some time before we get it. Perhaps we should have accompanying it a list of the actions that have followed from it, so we can catch up to date. Would members be happy about that? Good. Is there anything else on this particular report from the panel that members just want to explore? There are particular concerns about Park House, or less that's reported upon in this report publicly. We'll listen to any particular concerns and anxieties, but the key thing is that our meetings should satisfy ourselves that our very well organised staff under the team that we have are able to go in and find out exactly what's going on in this and all establishments, especially those causing concern.
Thank you, Chair. My point is exactly that. And one of the, whilst I'm aware that obviously what we discussed is an exempt matter, the working group asked for a chronology of the activities of the 18 in respect to this particular establishment. As yet, I've not received it, and I'm pretty sure that nobody else has received it either. And I think that's far from satisfactory. We were extremely concerned about this establishment and obviously others that belong to the same company. And the concerns that were expressed and the current state of that particular establishment. And I don't think asking for the chronology of the activities of the QA team around an organisation that has had several previous inadequate reports. This is not the first time. I don't think that's the unreasonable ask, and I would expect you to have that by now.
Yes,
I must apologise on behalf of the QA team that hasn't been supplied as yet, and I will raise that as as an urgent matter to be there for the board.
We received a note that report and take home ask officers to act on the concerns raised by members about the circulation of the documents. Is that intended there? Oh, sorry, Councillor Norbury, I wasn't looking far away in the distance. Thank you.
You know, I know the report and the comments that have been made, but I am very, very concerned regarding the standard of nursing home care, and obviously that's why the working party has been set up. We've got 20 nursing homes here on the Wirral that are requiring improvements, and as a pattern to this, what I need to know, what I want the committee to particularly investigate is where do we go when these nursing homes are constantly going into requires improvements and inadequate. These are our people. These are our people that are receiving inadequate healthcare, and these nursing homes are breaking the care constantly. So, reading the report, there's basically no wiggle room really. They talk about 8% spare capacity, and I know that family and people who are concerned about their relatives can't put them into another care home if that's possible. But where's the solution to all this? If that's not possible. And moving people from care homes creates a problem in itself for people's health and well-being. So where's the end destination in all this? How do we solve the problem instead of commenting and talking about it?
I'm sure officers are reply in detail, but the panel have reports, have a spreadsheet about all homes, had the ratings from CQC about all homes, looked at the homes who were getting the poorer ratings at the bottom right list. Officers were asked to keep a regular view on the homes near the bottom list, especially homes that seemed to dip in and out of improvement, might be the best description, that they have problems identified, the owners then take steps to try and improve things then might slip back. And that's what was causing concern to members of the committee. And we were receiving assurances from Amanda Barry-Mateo that our team went in and out of these premises, especially if the premises were causing concern, and would certainly be reporting back. But the whole purpose of their work was to try and force up standards throughout the sector. And you're quite right in saying that if a home was in difficulty, people had to be moved. That's very distressing for the residents and a great anxiety for the relatives. But I'd say, who would like to come to ground? Do you know what was by anything?
I think I would agree and echo Councillor Norbury's comments. It simply isn't good enough. It is a dilemma that we've got as a country as well as locally in Wirral, that the care that we provide for our population simply isn't good enough. We don't fund it high enough, and the quality of care is often nowhere near what we would expect. The team did work hard to focus on improvement. Has recently been a proposal from the contracts team which looks at what happens when homes keep going into requires improvement, and that looks at how we can actually cease contracting with those establishments. That will have an impact in terms of the availability of beds across the system. That needs to have an impact on the hospital, of course. Top and bottom, we can't continue to place people in homes that don't meet the standards and need to take action.
I'm going to check with Alex if we have a date fixed for our next panel meeting. 9th of October, right? Mary.
Thank you, Chair.
issues